Carolyn with us today. Gabe's mom's with us. Good to have Grace and Ari and Will here today. So if you see other visitors, reach out to them. Let them know you're glad they're here. Just take a minute and reach out to one another. Gentlemen, you can come on forward for prayer. And as we go to prayer today, continue to remember the Noss family. And, of course, they laid her mom to rest in Kentucky yesterday. A friend of Greg's was laid to rest yesterday, Brady, and just pray for his family. And folks that are sick, there's several people that are sick right now. Especially remember, if you would, Marianne Myers. She is having some big-time heart issues right now, so we need to remember her as well. But what we mainly need to pray for is that God will just do a work right here. And God just do a good work today. And so I'm going to ask Mike Nicewarner, Mike, if you just stand where you're at and just turn and lead us in prayer and ask God to work in our service today, please. Amen. Amen. Well, the men are going to return to their seat, and Paul Hickman's around here somewhere, coming to cause trouble. And
we'll give him a little break. Good morning. And you may be seated if you're still standing up. If you're happy to be here, let's get your hand way up in the air. If you're happy the person beside you, in front of you, or behind you is here, we get the other hands up in the air. And while we have our hands in the air, all God's people said, praise the Lord. 4:15, we do have a teacher's meeting in the Nicely Room. For anyone that is in a teaching ministry, even if you're an assistant in a teaching ministry, downstairs in the Nicely Room, 4:15. Bible study hours at 5 o'clock this evening. Now, our midweek service, we do have at 6:45, we have the Awana and Teens. It's an Awana theme night. This is a pajama party with very strict guidelines. The word modesty should come to mind. And if not, you'll be handed a robe. So don't be walking around in one of the robes. So modesty pajama party. And at 7 o'clock, they do have the adult Bible study. No pajamas for that. And prayer. We do have Caleb's clan at 10 o'clock in the morning downstairs in the fellowship hall. We're going to be looking again at some cultural differences from our Western culture to the Middle Eastern culture and how it relates to the Bible. Now, Saturday, February the 25th, that's next Saturday at 5:30, we're going to have a men's fellowship dinner down at the South Texas Barbecue Company in Weston, West Virginia. You can meet us there at 5:30, or you can come to the church at 4:50 p.m., and we'll just load a van up and go down there. There is sign-up sheets in the foyers for anyone wanting to go, and that way we have a good head count for them, so they'll be prepared for us. Now, next Sunday, February 26th, there is a deacons and trustees meeting after the Bible study hour. Deacons and trustees pack a lunch for that. So Just be prepared. Now, Sunday, this is some of the future things. March the 12th, we do have the time change back to daylight savings time, and that's when our services will change also. And we always say, please make a note on that so you show up where you need to be and where God wants you to be at the right time. Now, March the 16th, there's a youth rally at Bible Baptist Temple, and it features Bob Holmes. If anyone's ever seen Bob Holmes, and I know you've seen him when you were a teenager, you know, he's getting up there in age, but he's a one-man volleyball team, and he's pretty awesome. But he's even better as an evangelist to the teens. So that's going to be a great time. Please make a note for that. Of course, March the 23rd through the 26th is our missions conference. Its a theme is Remember Me. March the 23rd through the 25th is the ladies' prayer advance. And just a little future thing, March the 29th is the Awana Grand Prix. And I always look forward to that. That's just a great time. The last thing that I have, you may be getting old when. It's when wrinkles mean you laughed, gray hair means you cared, and scars mean you lived. It's when your idea of exercise is standing through all five verses of Just As I Am. It's when you consider multitasking something that you're doing while trying to remember what you were doing in the first place. It's when you max out all the font size on all your electronic devices and still need reading glasses. It's when you realize that prayer is a lifestyle, not an emergency exit. And forgiveness won't change the past, but it'll change the future. It's when you learn not to count the days, but make the days count. It's when silence becomes a luxury. It's when, hey, y'all, watch this, is replaced by, hey, y'all, I'm taking a nap. And my last one, when the older you get, the less life in prison is a deterrent. Thank you very much.
All right, I'll have you guys stand again. We're going to sing a song that will be on the screen for you. It's Wonderful, Merciful Savior. We're going to sing all three verses of that.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one that we pray. We pray.
You may be seated, and we're going to sing one last song, number 428, I Need Thee Every Hour. We're going to sing the first, second, and fourth verses.
By simply saying peace.
strongest wind. That's why I shouldn't worry when the storm clouds come my way. I know that He is near to drive away my fear, and I can smile and say, I know the peace speaker, I know Him by name. Coming down from the Father above. When He says, peace, be still, they have to obey. I'm glad I know the peace speaker.
That's what He said. He would give peace to us. He said, let not your heart be troubled. Praise the Lord for His peace. His consoling, His comforting. So many things that we find in Jesus Christ. Before we get into the message today, I want to read this to you from our missionaries in Italy, from Paul and Kelly Childers. It says, dear faithful members of Grace Baptist Church, I am writing this letter to let you know how much we appreciate the donation you gave toward the purchase of a new van for our family. The need was great, and God greatly provided for the need through your generosity. We were able to find a very suitable van through a friend for a great price. We praise God for you, for your prayers, for your faithful support of the ministry here in Italy, and for your special help in this time of need. Thank you, Paul Childers. So thank you, those who gave back in November, December toward this. They now are expecting their 10th child, and so they need a big van, a big van. A couple things I want to make note of. This upper-level parking lot, like to try to reserve that for people who are, like me, elderly. Our elderly members, and for those who have health issues. So if you tend to park up there but you don't have major health issues and you could park below, that would be helpful in making sure we have enough spaces up top, and that would be a big help if you would just consider doing that. I hope a lot of guys will go on Saturday. So again, Paul mentioned that we're going to have the van here leaving about 4:50 on Saturday afternoon. So if you can come out and be part of that, just want to have some times of fellowship. So we'll do this on occasions, kind of get back to what we did in the past before that thing that happened back in 2020. So if you're able to come out, guys, I think it's really good. Now, you may go there and say, I don't like this place, But you have to come first to find out if you don't like it. So I think you will. It was really, really good. So hope you'll come out and be part of that this Saturday evening. I want you to take your Bibles this morning and turn to Isaiah chapter 57. Isaiah chapter 57. One other announcement. Barbara Sims is sick, and my wife has been sick most of the week, and they have the nursery. They are the teachers of the nursery on Sunday evenings during Bible study hour. And so we definitely need some ladies that would step up. Maybe you don't normally come on a Sunday evening to Bible study. I'm going to ask that you would make an exception, and that I'd have some folks, when I stand in the back, just come by and volunteer. Just two ladies that would be able to watch the nursery tonight. If you don't normally work in the nursery, but you'd be willing to do it this time, then just please inform me as you leave, and that would be helpful. Now, we have substitutes for teaching positions in the normal classes, but we don't really have a substitute per se for this. So again, if you could help with that tonight, that would be a tremendous blessing if you would. We just sang the song, I Need Thee Every Hour. Let's do this as a prayer. Just sing the chorus again, because that song says exactly what we need. We need him. So let's just sing that chorus as a prayer, and then we get into the scripture.
I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Psalm 57, verse 15. For thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy place with him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite ones. The word revive is used twice in this verse. If I take this verse at face value, I can personally and do acknowledge that I can't have revival in my life. I believe the Holy Spirit desires to do that in any believer who is willing to meet the requirements that would accompany revival. There are people who do not believe that revival can happen today. And if you happen to be of that persuasion, I'm not going to try to fight against that. In a sense, I'm not even trying to convince you otherwise. I think good people who love the Lord believe that really cannot happen in this day and age. And they have their reasons for that. And you know what? That's fine. That's one thing about grace. We can be gracious to each other. And even when we differ in some things, even in this particular subject, that's fine. I'm fine with that. But for me personally, this again, I'll just put it this way, my personal opinion is that God can still do that work even today. Some of you might be aware of what is happening at Asbury University in Kentucky. Last Sunday morning, I texted a couple pastors here in this general area, including my son down in Louisville, and I just say, God, use you today. God, use you. I'm praying for you. And one of those men texted me back, and he said, do you know what's going on at Asbury? I said, I have no idea what you're talking about. But I think most people know now. I think most people know now. It's been on NBC News. It's been in the Washington Post, on CNN, on Fox News. I just watched an interview. In fact, I was thinking about playing the interview with Tucker Carlton, and I think it was the student body vice president or something like that there at the school. If you're familiar with a guy named Glenn Beck, he has interviewed somebody from the university. He has put it on his network, Blaze Network. Somebody said to me, well, you know, we Christians know about it, but, you know, if it's going to be real revival, the world's going to start to know. The last I heard, NBC News is not Christian by any stretch of the imagination. Asbury University is down in Wilmore, Kentucky. It's about an hour and a half from my son ministers. And I said, Corey, go down. Just see it for yourself. I could tell you three men who stood in this pulpit who've all gone down to view what is going on. Now, I don't know what you know. Don't know what you think of it. But something unusual is going on. And I've been trying to investigate it for myself because I know there can be such a thing, if you will, as false fire. Things that are not really of the Lord that would pretend to be of the Lord. One of the men who has stood in this pulpit on different occasions, I've been in contact with him and I've said, what do you think? And he personally believes that God is working. He personally believes that. I know other people that do not believe God is working, that it's not real. He wrote an article and said, this is the way that you know if something is the true work of God. And I'll just read this to you. He says, it produces a right view toward Jesus, which leads to overcoming Satan's lies and therefore deals with sin. Now he uses the passage out of 1 John chapter 4, verses 2 through 7. And that refers, that deals with that in verses 2 through 5. Secondly, he said, it produces a right view toward the Word of God, which is accompanied by the conviction of the Holy Spirit. That's according to 1 John chapter 4, verse 6. And then it produces love for God and others, which leads one to act on that love, according to 1 John 4, 7. Then he went on to say this. He said, through reading articles and personal posts and watching numerous videos from those on site, the best I can tell, this move, in the main, passes these tests. There is much emphasis on Jesus, the person of Jesus. He is exalted. He is the focus. The young people are thrilled with Jesus. There is much indication of dealing with sin, repentance, confession, apologies, forgiveness, healing of hearts, peace, and freedom. There is also much talk about the love in action with testimonies of love being lived out. In the main, this move clearly appears to pass the test of the Spirit in 1 John chapter 4. I rejoice. May this spirit of revival continue to have his way. This is not to say there might not be later developing aberrations of sorts, especially given that many have been drawn to the school from the outside. If you have been noticing what's going on now into its second week, thousands have descended on this little town, literally from all over the world. People from this area, again, at least three men who have stood in this pulpit have all gone down to find out for themselves their examination of it, to see if they think that it is really a movement of God. And he talks here about aberrations because with many of the great revivals of the past, the great awakenings, the great prayer revival in New York City, the move throughout the English-speaking world back in Moody and some of those great speakers in the English world, Charles Spurgeon and them, there's a great movement of God. There are aberrations. Satan will do everything he can to come in and try to take what is genuine and cause confusion. And he mentions that such occurrences have often happened during other revivals. So knowing this, we must be careful not to write off the real if an aberration takes root. And we must not embrace any aberration alongside of the real work taking place. The stream of aberration does not negate the real stream, and the real stream does not condone any aberrant stream. I think you understand what he means by an aberration or the aberrant way. In my reading and just watching for myself, I've not personally gone down, although I'm very tempted to do it. You have probably heard how it started just after a Wednesday chapel service, and some students stayed around and just never left. And for some reason, people started coming back in. Soon that auditorium was filled up, and then they had to go to overflow auditoriums, and 3,000 people descending on campus, lines a half a mile long trying to get into the place from people coming, and it hasn't stopped. It just hasn't stopped. And now it has spread to other places. Now, I'm going to mention some names of schools that I would never promote, nor would I ever encourage any of our young people to go to these schools. This particular school, Asbury, is a from the Wesleyan Holiness Movement. And I'm not condemning them. Please don't misunderstand me. It has swept into a school in Tennessee called Lee University. I've had three nephews and a niece attend there. I do not agree with the school in totality by any means, and I would never encourage an independent Baptist to go to that school. It has swept into Ohio at Cedarville University. And again, while it is more of an independent Baptist type, it has gone extremely contemporary. I took a group of our young people there for a special offer they were having back when I was youth pastor here, and even then, I had teenagers in my group say, "Pastor, we don't want to come back here anymore." It was like just a... We had one of our young ladies, one of the young ladies in my youth group that attended youth here when I was youth pastor, who graduated from Cedarville, her and her husband now pastor in another part of the state. So I'm very familiar with Cedarville. Many of the students from my home church years ago used to attend there, but I wouldn't recommend it today. I'm just being honest with you so that you understand what I'm about to say. I may not be in agreement with everything they do at any three of those schools, but I think I'd be foolish not to recognize that something is going on. Now, the Bible says you are to test the spirits, and that's what 1 John 4 does. You test the spirit. One of the pastors mentioned to me this past Friday during prayer time. He said, "You know, this is what I've told my people. Just as in the book of Acts where Gamaliel is speaking to the council and they're up in arms about the preaching of Jesus by Peter and others, and they want to imprison Peter, they want to imprison the disciples, they want to bring this to an end, they want to crush it." And Gamaliel says, "Whoa, if this is not of God, it will fall to the ground. It will die. But if this is of God, it doesn't matter what you do. You cannot stop it." And he said, "Do not fight against God." So my encouragement would be this: be cautious. You can't avoid hearing about it. A lot of you, because you're conservative, you watch Fox News and you're hearing about it. If you watch CNN, you're hearing about it. If you go to the major networks like NBC, you're hearing about it. You're hearing about these things. And if this continues, and may not, but if it does, you're going to hear more and more about it. And you need to ask the Lord to give you discernment, and you get discernment from his word. Now, the president of Cedarville University is a guy named Thomas White. Don't know him from Adam, but I want to read to you what he said. He said, "Tonight, a large number of students gathered again to pray, read scriptures, testimonies, and the words of Jesus for about 2 hours. We had two more students saved tonight. I remember at Bob Jones University, and I was there, we got snowed in Greenville. And they showed an old preaching film of Bob Jones Sr. And on that film, it was just a real basic salvation message. Nobody could leave campus to go to church, any of the local churches. We were all there, thousands of us. And I'm thinking, I could have preached that. That was so simple. You know, it's like, I wanted something more than just, you know, basic. I remember bunches of Bob Jones University students getting saved that night. And the thought, maybe God does know what he's doing. Sometimes I think I know what I'm doing. Really, God knows what he's doing, and I don't know diddly squat. So here, kids are getting saved at all these schools. At least I know of here and at Asbury, people are being saved. Goes on to say, "Tomorrow night we are sending out our students to other universities to share the gospel. Keep praying for wisdom and a genuine movement of the Lord." He went on to talk about to the faculty. It says, in an email to Cedarville faculty and staff earlier this week, White wrote, "We are so thankful for how God is working on our campus in recent days. The university's president explained it all began on Monday during Cedarville's morning campus chapel service while he led the students in studying Psalm 86. And then White went on to describe what happened next. And this is a quote from the president. He said, "I plan for us to pray as an application of David crying out to God and then sing a song before continuing with the sermon. During that song, the first person to come to the altar to pray was a faculty member. He was followed by students, one after another. As I walked back up to the stage, I knew the sermon was over and God was moving. Before long, the altar was packed with students down some of the aisles. We stayed even after the time for chapel had ended. We don't do this very often because we value the important work that takes place in classrooms across the campus at 11 a.m. But as I looked down at the students with tears of repentance dripping down from their cheeks while other students put arms around them to pray, I knew we needed to stay. God was doing something special. On Tuesday morning in chapel, when the speaker gave the invitation for students to come to the altar and to lay any idols preventing them from moving closer to God, and many students responded to the gospel call, according to White, students, staff, and faculty agreed to meet together that evening. White went on to say, we prayed through the Lord's Prayer on that Tuesday evening. We sang one song, heard a few testimonies, and then prayed through the Beatitudes. In the first 30 minutes, I think we only sang one song. I expected students might leave with less music, but not only did they stay, the numbers grew, he said. At the beginning of our next song, I saw a young lady with tears streaming down her cheeks come to the altar on my left. Then another in the middle, and another to the right came. I am not charismatic, but I felt the presence of the Lord in the room. It was palpable. Some students continued to linger, praying and singing. I noticed a young lady with a beaming smile waiting to talk to me. Her first words were, I was saved tonight. That makes four reported professions of faith this week. Praise God. Instead of having chapel on Wednesday night, Cedarville students who were called to do so took the gospel message to share at other colleges and university. White said he doesn't know exactly, this is important when you listen to what he says. He said that he doesn't know exactly what the Lord is doing, but he wants to stay humble before the Lord and allow for God to move while at the same time avoiding any exaggerations of what's taking place. Are we having a revival on campus? I think it is too soon to declare that. Maybe we are seeing a unique outpouring of the presence of God, and maybe we just experienced a few days of worship, he explained. We must keep the marks of genuine revival before us. Now listen to the genuine marks of revival according to him. We should see confession of sin, repentance, salvation, Jesus being exalted, and the word of God being held high. And that's exactly what I would refer to as a genuine revival. Everybody I know, I'm not an expert in revival, but I know some men who you would consider because this is what they study, and they would say that is exactly the marks of genuine revival. We must maintain a humble posture with no exaggerations as to what is happening, seeking to avoid fabricating something through emotional events on one side and hindering the work of the Spirit through skepticism or not encouraging the right opportunities on the other side. A genuine work of God must be organic, White noted. We don't know what to do next or what will happen next, but let's prepare our hearts to be ready just in case God graciously moves in our country, he continued. Ultimately, this is not about any person. It is not about Cedarville. So let's make sure we stay humble and give all credit to God. We desire that Jesus Christ be honored above all. I just stood here and told you I would not promote Cedarville University, nor Lee University, nor Asbury University. There are things that, for me personally as a pastor, trying to protect the flock that God's given me responsibility to, that if a parent said, would you recommend the school? I'd say no. But I can't deny that something is happening. Now we still need to, as President White said, we need to observe and make sure this is truly a work of God. But then I think it's been a group of pastors, we've been praying for 9 years for revival. As one of the men said Friday morning, he said, we're praying and we have said to God, we don't care where you start it. We just want you to start it. We just want to see you move in God's people and get us out of our lethargy, our whole hum attitude, coming quick and leave right away, and You know, here we have Outreach Saturday, and we have four people show up out of a church of 100, and that's not right. I think you know that. Say you're trying to embarrass us or make us feel bad. I think you know it's wrong. That's just not right. We need revival as much as any other people. We do. And I'll include myself in that. So if God wants to do a work, let him do a work. And if along the way he touches somebody that's from the Wesleyan Holiness and from the Church of God and from, you know, an independent Baptist group that's kind of gone really almost liberal in some ways, so be it. I mean, we sing hymns that are from Methodist and Presbyterians. There's even a Unitarian song in our hymnal. And we'll gladly sing those songs. Oh, this spoke to my heart. But if it's not an independent fundamental Baptist, we're ready to just, you know, say this can't be of God. When did we independent Baptists corner the market on God? So I think we just need to make sure we step back and say, God, yeah, I can't declare that it's this or that, but God, just help me to look at your word, judge it according to your word without being condemning. And God, if you really are doing a work, then God, let it come this way. When I prayed Friday morning, the invitation hymn, pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. Why on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. If God is calling people to repentance and revival in Kentucky and in Ohio and in Tennessee, let it sweep into West Virginia. Let it sweep into West Virginia. I want to speak to you for a little bit about the requirements for revival. Requirement number one, there must be a recognition of the need for revival. I would take notes if I were you. There must be a recognition for revival. And I don't think most people have a clue or care whether or not we have revival. I'm just being blunt. I just don't think many Christians care. Just like when I go out there, John was with me yesterday, we're out trying to witness to people. Most people just don't care. They're just satisfied with life. I want you to look at Habakkuk chapter 3. Habakkuk chapter 3, it's toward the end of the Old Testament. Habakkuk chapter 3, and look at verse 2. Here's another amazing thing when you study the history of revival. Many times it starts with young people, with teenagers and young adults. Why, I do not know. That's strange, isn't it? That's good. Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 2. O Lord, I have heard thy speech and was afraid. O Lord, revive thy works in the midst of the years. In the midst of the years, make known in wrath, remember mercy. God, make us alive again. Get out of this lethargy. God, make us alive again. Revive us. What led Habakkuk to say that? Well, go back to chapter 1 and look at verse 1 of Habakkuk. And it says, the burden which Habakkuk the prophet did see. Do we have a burden? Do we have a burden like Habakkuk had toward our sin, toward the condition of our homes, toward the condition of our church, toward the condition of our community, toward the condition of our nation? Do we have a burden? The burden which Habakkuk the prophet did see. Now notice, he saw, he recognized something. What did he see? Verse 2, O Lord, how long shall I cry, and thou wilt not hear? Even cry unto thee of violence, and thou wilt not save. Why dost thou show me iniquity, and cause me to behold grievance? For spoiling and violence are before me, and there are that raise up strife and contention. Therefore the law is slacked, and judgment doth never go forth. For the wicked doth compass about the righteous, therefore wrong judgment proceedeth. When I read those words, it's like that is the United States of America. This is the condition of our country. Habakkuk recognized Israel needed revived. He saw it. He recognized it. Look over at Psalm 85. Psalm 85. Psalm 85, we'll look at verse 6. Wilt thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? Now, why did the psalmist say this? We'll go back to verse 1. Lord, thou hast been favorable unto thy land. Thou hast brought back the captivity of Jacob. Thou hast forgiven the iniquity of thy people. Thou hast covered all their sin. Selah, that means think about it. He said, in years past, there have been times when your people have rebelled against you and gone into sin, and you have been faithful to forgive them. You have been faithful to bring them out of captivity. Remember what I preached last Sunday morning? Sometimes God sends us into captivity. Brother Homestead mentioned in the New Testament, I wish I thought about it, that Jesus Christ came to do what? To lead captivity captive. You said, that's God, that's what you've done in the past. Verse 3. Thou hast taken away all thy wrath. Thou hast turned thyself from the fierceness of thine anger. Verse 4. Turn us, O God of our salvation, and cause thine anger toward us to cease. Wilt thou be angry with us forever? Wilt thou draw out thine anger to all generations? Wilt thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? The psalmist says, God, in the past we have fallen away from you. We have gone into this spiritual morass. You have revived us in the past. God, would you not do it again? Revive us again. The United States has known major revivals. What's a little bit scary and may make it pause on revival is sometimes those revival happens before great calamity in the nation. A great revival broke out right before the Civil War and so forth. The way I pray for the United States is this, right? And you've heard me say this, I think. I do not pray for God to bless America. I say, God, I know you will judge America according to your word. And we cannot escape it. But I do ask this. I ask that you would revive your church. And that through reviving your church before your judgment, that you would save, if not thousands, then millions of people in this nation before you bring your wrath upon this nation. We are a vile and wicked nation. I'm as red, white, and blue as any of you. And in some ways, maybe more. And I've been addressed about that from some of the congregation. But I recognize where we're at. And it's not Washington that needs revival. It's God's people that needs revival. God doesn't revive the lost. He revives his people. Pew Research found back in 2020 that 64% of Americans identify as Christians. It's not a bad percentage. Another 30% identify as non-religious. In 1972, 92% of Americans identified as Christians. That is a massive fall from 1972 to 2020. And they say that by the year 2070, it'll be down to 50%. In other words, half the nation will be anti-Christian, most of them agnostic and atheistic. We're going to the same area that North Korea is in, and China is in, and several other nations that give themselves over to a communist leftist point of view toward the world. That's where we're headed. In 2017, Lifeway did a research. Lifeway is a big Southern Baptist group, and they did a survey of young adults between the ages of 18 to 22. And they said that those who attended church regularly for at least 1 year during high school. Today, those young people, 7 of 10 drop out of church completely. Out of those who, and you know, that's kind of a low standard to me. You know, they go to church, you know, at least, you know, one time a week or whatever the poll said. And then when they become adults, 7 out of 10 leave altogether. Why is that? What is it that these young people don't see in me? What is it that these young people don't see in us who are adults? And that's not a Presbyterian problem. It's not a Lutheran problem. That's everybody's problem. It's across the board. University of Chicago did a survey in 2022. 67% of Americans attend church at least once a year. That's a low standard, once a year. That's down from 75% before the pandemic. And there are people who have never stepped back foot in this church since the pandemic hit in March of 2020, and probably never will. Do we need a revival? I don't know what you think. I think I do. I think Christianity does. And that's a requirement. We've got to recognize the need. And if we're just kind of going through life like, hey, everything's great, you know, the economy's not quite as bad as it said it would be. You'll go out today, you drive down the road, you'll see restaurants packed out, you'll see Walmart packed out, Kroger's packed out, people going about their way. They don't seem too rattled. And most people don't recognize their need. May God help us as his children to recognize the need. Secondly, there has to be a readiness to humble ourselves. You've heard much preaching about 2 Chronicles 7:14. You've heard me preach about it. Other men preach about it. Remember the beginning of that verse. If my people, which are called by my name, shall what? Humble themselves. Once I recognize a need, I must be willing to humble myself. There has to come a moment where we stop saying, something's wrong in our nation. Something's wrong with the church. Something's wrong, and start humbling ourselves. It's not the government. It's not the liberals. It's not the LGBTQ crowd. It's not Antifa. It's not BLM. God, I need to humble myself in order for you to work a revival. Thirdly, not only do I need to recognize a need for it and have a readiness to humble myself, I have to be willing to repent of sin. And the one thing that gives me hope with what's happening at Asbury and Lee and at Cedarville and several other colleges, apparently now this is continuing to spread, is there is an attitude among the young people to repent. That has been a theme, repentance. I mean, young people coming and crying out to God and saying, I have done wrong, I have sinned against you, and naming the sin and forsaking it. Now, we may not be the same stripe, but brother, I'm all about people repenting. Look at Psalm 32. Look at Psalm 32 and verse 2. Blessed is the man, or the woman, or the teenager, anyone. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. When I kept silence, my bone waxed old through my roaring all the day long. For day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned into the drought of summer. Think about that, Selah. Notice verse 5. I acknowledged my sin unto thee, and mine iniquity have I not hid? I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. Selah. Think about that. We need to be thinking about that. There needs to be an acknowledgement of our sins and a willingness to turn from our sins. And not just say, I'm just hot-tempered. That's why I said what I said. It's my Irish blood in me. That's why I said what I said about that person. Why don't we, including myself, acknowledge sin? Confess it. Proverbs 28:13. He that covereth his sin shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh him, he shall have mercy. Confess and forsake the sin. That's called turning. It's called repentance. Turning from sin. I find this interesting. You don't have to turn there. But in the book of Revelation, chapters 2 and 3, if you have a red letter edition of your Bible, you'll notice all those chapters in red. Because it's Jesus speaking. And Jesus, as he speaks to those early churches, the church of Philadelphia, the church at Laodicea, the church at Ephesus, and so on, those churches, as he speaks to them, six times he tells the church, not the lost, he tells the church, repent. He says it in Revelation 2:5, Revelation 2:16, Revelation 20:21, or Revelation 2:21, Revelation 2:22, Revelation 3:3, and Revelation 3:9. I'm going to read one of those. There are many who believe, and I tend to lean this way, that the church of Laodicea represents the last age before the return of Jesus Christ. Now, some of you may not believe that. So I'm just giving you my opinion, okay? If you disagree with that, please don't come to me after the service and say, well, Pastor, I have a problem with what you said. Okay, it won't be the first time people have had problems, so, you know, just don't do that to me. I personally think it is a mirror image of the state of the church before Jesus Christ comes back. I personally believe we are in the last days. I believe, in general, this is the Laodicean church age. Now, there was a church at Laodicea, and I did have these literal problems, but I believe it represents different stages of the church through history. So, whether or not that's true, the point is this. When Jesus deals with the church at Laodicea, in fact, it's probably good if we saw it together. Go to Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3. And look at verse 15. He says to the church at Laodicea, I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Now, a lot of people will say, well, this church is the false church, therefore it's not genuine believers. I have big problems with that. As you continue to read, notice he says, because thou sayest, and again, when I think about this, I just think about the condition that we're in as a society. I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. And knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. Because I have a job and a house and a car and a comfortable church auditorium and a brand new building, does not make me right with God. But those things do tend to convince my mind, I don't have anything, I don't have any needs. I'm fine just like I am. So many times when you go out and you tell people the gospel, because most Americans, even those, there are probably several people in this auditorium who are classified as, according to our government, as poor, with our flat screen TVs, our automobiles, our central air conditioning, the food that fills our pantries and our refrigerators, and we're considered poor. Really? He said, you don't know you're wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. You don't see your spiritual state because you have everything. And so there's no stirring, no need for revival. Why would I want anything to interrupt my schedule? Why would I want to stay around after the service to pray and to cry out to God? Now, I'm not trying to make something happen that is not of the Lord today. Please don't misunderstand me. But my mindset is, if there is anybody materialistic, it's the young generation of our country. And I don't mean to offend you who are younger, but that is a major, of course, it's probably true of the older generation too. But the point is this, those young people, you say, well, they're just avoiding going to class. And you know what, when I was in college, both colleges, you know, if I could avoid going to class, you know, great, you know. I'm just being honest with you. But they're also avoiding their date nights and their activities and their sleep to let God deal with them. Look at verse 18. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eye with eye salves, that thou mayest see. Here's why I believe he's speaking to genuine believers. Verse 19, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. That's exactly what he says to the believers in Hebrews. Whom the Lord loveth, he chasteth and scourgeth. This is something he does to his children. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and what? Repent. That's not saying to, that's not being said to the lost and dying world. It's being said to God's people that he loves. He said, you need to get right. You need to repent. And we need to recognize that, the need for repentance. Two more things I want you to notice before we close. We need to recognize our need for revival, have a readiness to humble ourselves, a willingness to repent of sin, and fourthly, a reverence to the leading of the Holy Spirit. I've come to the point after 39 years of ministry and 40 plus years of preaching to believe that I don't understand everything about God and that the Holy Spirit often moves in ways that don't fit my box. And I'm not talking about false fire. I mean, I am a fundamental, independent King James Baptist, and I desire to be nothing else. And as long as I'm your pastor, we ain't moving from those things. But I recognize God works in other groups. It's the reality, if I'm honest. It's just the reality. And so God can do what he chooses. And I don't always understand it. But I'm not going to be like some who are trying constantly to fight it. I don't mean accept everything. I'm just saying, let the Holy Spirit lead. We need to reverence the leading of the Holy Spirit. In Luke chapter 4, Jesus is being taken into the wilderness. You know who's taking him into the wilderness? The Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit who is leading him into this place where he will not eat or drink for 40 solid days. Oh, the Holy Spirit would never lead me into that kind of a scenario, wouldn't he? He did to the very Son of God. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted and to suffer. In Acts chapter 13, the church is now spread outside of Jerusalem from among the Jews and has now begun to affect the Gentile world. And probably the greatest church of the era was not the church at Jerusalem. It was the church at Antioch in Syria. It was the missionary-minded church. It was the church that walked really by faith. It's where Paul and Silas and many others were anchored. It was their, if you know, we use about missionaries the term, sending church. They were the sending church. And in Acts chapter 13, it says this in verse 2. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. So they, being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, departed unto Seleucia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus. Holy Spirit said, do this, and they did it. Whether it made sense to people or not, they just obeyed the Holy Spirit. They reverenced the leadership of the Holy Spirit of God. When I was growing up, I went to a very strong, two strong Bible preaching churches. You hear me talk about them a lot because it's one of the cherished things of my youth and my childhood. And I remember this, especially in our fundamental circles, we made people memorize these two verses. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. What? Know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own, for ye are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your spirit and in your body, which are God's. The Holy Ghost lives in us. We're not to hinder him. We're warned, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Don't grieve him. Don't stop the work of the Holy Spirit. Well, what does that mean for me? That I need to reverence him because he is God. He is God, the Holy Spirit. I need to reverence his leading. God, whatever you want me to do, I'll do. If you tell me go be a plumber, I'll be a plumber. And I tell God this to this day. I say, God, because I ask God to call people out of this church to serve him in full-time ministry. I'm be honest, I do. I say, God, if you want to move Debbie and me, you move us. If you want to lead us to somewhere else, God, you do what you want to do. Now, he hasn't. But I say, Holy Spirit, you have your way. All of us need to be reverencing the leadership of the Holy Spirit in our life and saying, Holy Spirit, you take control. You lead me. Even in this matter of examining what's going on these college campuses, the last thing is this. Requirements for a work of revival. Yes, we have to have a recognition of the need for revival. We need a readiness to humble ourselves. We need a willingness to repent of sin. We need a reverence to the leading of the Holy Spirit. And finally, we need a reliance on God's word. We need a reliance on God's word. Look at the book of Jeremiah, chapter 23. Jeremiah, chapter 23. In verse 28, the prophet that hath a dream, let him tell a dream. And he that hath my word, let him speak my word faithfully. What is the chaff to the wheat? Saith the Lord. Is not my word like a fire, saith the Lord, and is like a hammer that breaketh the rock in pieces? The comparison here is to the prophets who have dreams, because there were many false prophets in the days of Jeremiah and leading God's people astray. In fact, these prophets were basically saying to the people, you're okay just like you are. Keep living in your sin. It's okay. God will take care of you. He said, what is the chaff? It's the wheat. The Bible talks about the word being sweet to our taste and eating it. I esteem thy word more than my necessary food. He calls it the wheat, the food of the word of God. Listen, we need to have a reliance on it. Hebrews 4:12, we know it. Many of you have it memorized. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and it is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. It's like a surgical knife that can go in and really examine us and bring encouragement when we need encouragement and conviction when we need conviction, That's why I read it every day. I got up this morning and spent time in my Bible. I'll do it tomorrow. I'll do it Tuesday. I'll do it Wednesday. I'll do it Thursday. I will not step aside from this book. Psalm 119, verse 30. The entrance of thy word giveth light. It giveth understanding to the simple. I'm a simple-minded man. And I need this book. I need it. Those are requirements, I think, to see a work of revival come. And then after I finished this, I looked and said, you know, it may be requirements, but that's also the reality when revival comes. When revival comes, we do walk in humility. We are quick to repent of sin. We are willing to reverence the leading of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And this book takes second place to nothing in our life when revival comes. I'm going to be honest with you. Right now, and this, you know, next week we may come in and all those things at those schools have died off and everybody's back to normal. I'm going to be honest with you, right now it's almost like I can taste it. I want God to work. I want God to work in me. I want God to work in you. I share one other thing before I close. Throughout the Old Testament, you hear this phrase, turn us again, O God, turn us again. And to me, whether it's in the Psalms or in the book of Lamentations where Jeremiah says it, it's like an acknowledgement. God, I really do want this, but you know me. And you know how difficult sometimes it is to be willing to deal with a sin issue in my life and to forsake it. God, you know how hard it is for me to commit myself to this book and to seek the leadership of the Holy Spirit. You know that. So God, where I cannot turn myself, God, you turn me. And I've come to that point. God, if you have to do some things. And I had to preach this past Monday. And I gave an illustration of God forcing my hand to repentance. I won't reveal to you what it was several years ago, but in order to see God work in a certain situation, God had to bring me to a point where he forced my hand over a besetting sin that I had in my life. And he did. And when I confessed it and I dealt with it, God answered that prayer. God did a great work. And sometimes we just need to be willing to get serious with God. And he basically says in his word, you get serious with me, I'll get serious with you. You toy with me? Okay, if that's the way you want it. Where are we at? Where am I at? You know, we've sung the song, Do You Really Want Revival? Do you really want God's power? So I ask myself, do I really want it? Do I really want to see God work in my life? And I need you to ask yourselves that question. I don't know where you're thinking. I can't tell by your expressions. I can't tell. And partly because these kind of blur my vision when I see you, so I can't, you know, you could be sticking your tongue out at me and I couldn't really tell. Please don't do that. But would you go before God today and say, God, if this truly is a work of your Holy Spirit and you are beginning to do what many have prayed for now for years, just found out this week in Europe, there have been groups who pray 24/7. They have somebody praying every single hour for revival. They've been doing it now for over a decade. I don't know who the people are. Don't know where they're at. I don't know if it's Italy or Germany or France or Spain. I don't know. But different groups have just, God, we need outpouring of your Holy Spirit on us. We need a work of God done. And sometimes it goes for decades with people pleading with the Lord. Maybe he's just saying, I just want to see if you're really serious about this, if you're just going to quit. Say, well, that doesn't work. Well, I'm not ready to quit. I just ask, if nothing else, you just go before the Lord and say, God, if this is really of you, would you do a work in me? Would you help me to be open before you? Will you bow your head in prayer? You do what you need to do this morning. You know the routine. If you need to come, you come. Sometimes people turn right at the bench they're at and they make it an altar and they pray, or you can sit there and pray, or you can go to another part of the building and pray. You do what God wants you to do. Patty, you can go ahead and just play lightly if you would. We certainly need him. I need him. Let's stand together and we'll close in prayer. I'm going to ask Brother Harold, if you wouldn't mind, just lifting up your voice and praying as we close.